Hi, I'm Paulshinn. Welcome back to my YouTube channel, the most boomer-oriented car channel with the squeakiest garage doors in all of YouTube. Today, we're installing a Mitchell Overdrive in a Ford Model A. Now, luckily, I was able to borrow this Model A from my friend Bill and his lovely wife, Barbara. And in fact, I used to own this car. I sold this car to Bill a little over a year ago. Fantastic car, cutest coupe you ever saw. And it's about to become a little bit faster. Today's patient is an early 1930 standard coupe model 45 Bravo. Ford built about 226,000 of these in 1930. It sold new for $490. My dad and I found this car literally in a barn. It had been abandoned for pretty close to 30 years, and the property was just starting to be vandalized, so we pitched in, both of us, and bought this car for way too much for what it was, got it home, and immediately started working on it. We ended up doing clutch and brakes and had to put an interior in it because the interior was gone, and did a whole bunch of work to this car, fixed it up, didn't do paint because the paint was decent. But anyway, we got this car running and driving fantastic. It was a great car, and then we never drove it. It sat for like 2 or 3 years until we met Bill and Barbara Link, and it's like this was the perfect car for them, so we made it theirs, and they've been giving it the love it deserves ever since.
There are several different overdrives that you can install in a Ford Model A. Right now on the market today, the most popular is made by Mitchell Manufacturing Company, and we have a brand new one right here. Unboxing videos are popular on YouTube. So let's do one right now. Unboxing the Mitchell Overdrive. So the first thing we have in here, let me see the Overdrive shows up. We have instructions. You don't want to lose these. Your packing list, what came in the box here. Hopefully it's all here. Along with instructions, they include this gasket here goes where the pinion goes into the banjo. And of course his invoice and everything else all in one nice tidy box. And the hardware we're going to need. This installation. Stuck here. All the goodies. This is what mounts on the transmission for the shifter arm, the extension for the speedometer cable. We're going to need that for sure. That's the coupler, the vent tube. You've got to have your stickers and your tools that you're going to need. Okay, they even include gaskets. That's nice. I bought a set of gaskets. Didn't even need it. There's the shift lever we're going to be installing in the interior. This is the shifting leakage. Right here, and the rear half shaft, we're going to be installing this. This is where the pinion assembly is going to go on here. We've got a tool for that. And then in here, of course, the main overdrive assembly. This thing is really heavy, so I'm going to get some help unpacking this.
All right, time to get to work. Very first step, since you're going to have the rear end of this car sticking way up in the air, block the front wheels. Then we're going to pull out the floorboard, just the rear board. You don't have to pull out the very front one that's right under the dashboard, just the bottom board. Get everything out of the way, because next we're going to have to take apart the clamshell. Don't take the bolts totally out yet. Just get them loose so that you can take them out by hand once you get under the car. Next step, got to take the wheels off. So loosen the lug nuts before the tires are off the ground, because once you jack it up, it's really hard to get torqued lug nuts loose. All right, time to get your back dirty, get under the car. You have to remove these four nuts here that hold the rear spring in place. So first thing is take the cotter pins out, then take your 7/8 wrench and break these loose. They shouldn't be overly tight, but they're going to be pretty tight. So break them loose with your wrench first. Then after I've gotten them broken loose, then I grab my 7/8 ratchet wrench and take them out all the way. Ta-da! All right, next step is to get under the middle of the car. We have to take the rear brake rods and parking brake rods loose. So pull the cotter pins and then pull the rods. Now that we got all this room under the car, now is where I go ahead and pull the clamshell. And you see I've also already removed the speedometer drive cable from the speedometer drive clamshell.
Because this thing's so full of grease and goop. This pan's down here not just because of the motor leaking. This pan's here for a reason.
Quick slide.
We're going to move it out of the way when we put the dolly under this to catch the torque tube. But for right now, I want it there. Because you never know what's going to come out of this right here.
Wow.
See how greasy that is? That's good.
Yeah.
That's what you want. That means
I asked you once, how many times you grease it? Well, until you think it's got enough.
And then a little bit more.
And then put in a little bit. Yes, that's what you said.
That's right. That's the right way to do it.
And that's what I did.
That's what it's supposed to look like, by the way. People, you want your U-joint to look like this inside. That's what you want. Ta-da! Okay, now that we're ready to pull the rear end out, put a trolley or a dolly under the front of the torque tube. C-clamp on this center just in case for safety, because if this thing lets go,
bolt breaks, we got a missile.
If the bolt, yeah,
that bolt breaks,
if that bolt breaks, somebody's gonna die. Yes, for sure. So I don't know if this will really hold it or not, but it sure makes me feel better.
It would wipe out the building, everybody around it.
Oh yeah, it would be very unpleasant. There, I feel better already.
One rod. There we go.
All right, now let me get the jack under it. Right there.
There she is.
That's it. Okay. Now the fun begins.
Before we can remove the torque tube from the rear end, we first have to remove the speedometer drive clamshell, and then we have to pull that little retainer ring inside. I'll show you that in a moment. Deep down inside the front, if you look real close, there's a little retainer ring around those splines on the end of the drive shaft. Two screwdrivers is about the only way I've ever really found to remove that. So we're going to have to pull that little ring out, and then we can pull the speedometer drive gear.
Where the speedometer drive was. We'll push this bearing out right there. There you go. There's the drive for the speedometer gear. Yep. Done deal.
Next, we're going to use wire cutters to remove all the safety wire that was on here previously. Then we're going to use a 9/16 socket with an extension and remove these bolts. Now we have to use a 7/8 wrench and remove the bolt in the front of the torque tube.
I don't think we're going to tighten it that much when we put it back on. You only got to get it tight and then find the cotter pin hole. That's it.
Yeah.
It'll come out nice. Off nice and easy. There we go. Here's the fancy rinses that you need in order to get the pinion nuts off. Usually, after flattening that washer, the top one comes off pretty easy. The bottom one, sometimes you're going to have to grab onto the shaft with the pipe wrench. But before we remove the bottom nut, we're going to index it so that we can put it back exactly where it is now, so we can try and keep our preload setting way it is, assuming it's correct in the first place. All right, this nut here, we're going to find where the index is there, and then I'll use my sacrificial screw. You could use a punch. If I knew where my punches were, I would have used a punch. Make a mark on the nut, so theoretically we can put it back exactly where it is. Wrench on the shaft here. Get it the right way. Off with the nut. There it is. Alright. That's off. It may or may not wiggle out. This one's just going to wiggle out. Look at that, Bill. Just like your other one did.
Not quite.
Oh, almost. Alright, we're going to have to use the puller. All right, this is the Mitchell pinion puller tool. I went ahead and I put grease on the threads here. You need a 5/8 socket. Leslie, set it to tighten. Okay, now you take that nut you just pulled off right here, slide that back over. We're gonna semi-tighten this. The trick here is to make sure you pull that pinion out perfectly straight. You don't want to get it at an angle. You'll crack the banjo housing or cause other damage. You don't want to do that. All right. Get that just kind of semi-tight. Can't get the wrench in there now, of course, but trust me, it's tight. You want to make sure you're not on any of the threads. Yeah. Looks like we missed them. They're good. A little tension on these. Okay. Use your fingers, feel it. Feels pretty straight. Now I'll get my socket and I'll start cranking on this. Remember, this has to be done evenly. If this starts getting cattywampus at an angle, fix it right away. Feel around. This side's just a tad low right here. There we go. Okay, now. Two cranks. Feel. Goes, get all this old gasket off. That's it. Piece of cake. Ta-da! Most people would use the proper size wrench. I'm using a adjustable wrench. Don't judge me. Alright. Get this nut off. See, when you go to the gym, you don't need fancy tools. You just need brute strength. Alright, next step to get the carrier off of the shaft is to thread the nut back on to where it's about flush with the bottom of the threads here. We want to protect the threads. Set it on something wood-like. Now we're going to get this collar, which comes in the Mitchell kit. That protects the threads on the carrier. And then we just take something heavy, round, that fits over it.
I'm not going to lie, this is actually kind of therapeutic.
And that loosens the carrier. Now we can take the whole bearing race and carrier and everything right off in one chunk. It comes off. Get that piece like that. Ta-da! Now this shaft we're not going to use because we're going to be using this one that came with the Mitchell Overdrive. Then we got to mount this onto here next. With the rear drive shaft firmly locked in vice, the key in place, slide the pinion carrier over the shaft, get it seated as best you can. Thread the nut on, make sure you don't cross thread this, please. That would be horrible. Get your 15/16 wrench. And we're gonna get so much torque on this, we can't possibly torque it anymore by hand. I don't know what the exact torque figure is, but it's a lot. Since the hole for the cotter, I've got it set up to where it's perfectly up and down, I know right where the hole is. So as I put this on and tighten it down, I can see exactly where I need to end up on the castle nut so that I can get that cotter back in. All right, here we go. Two hands. How tight. And I am right on the money. The trick to putting this cotter pin in is to make sure that you don't have anything coming up over the end of this shaft here. If you install this and then you bend one side of it up over this, then that'll end up hitting the spider gear carrier inside the differential. You don't want to do that. That'll make you cuss.
Better?
Better. All right. Okay, now with the pinion carrier back on, bearing has got the lower nut on to make sure that holds it all together. We're about ready to press this in, but first I'm going to clean up this flange. So I just take a rag, stuff it in here to make sure I don't get anything in there. Scraper. Just make sure any old gasket, anything else is off this flange so I get a good seal. Get everything out of those little grooves. You'll see where it's machined on this flange. Just make sure I got everything out of those grooves. That's good. Okay. Perfect. All right, and with your cotter pin in place, everything's tight. You got that first nut on. It's time to press this into the banjo housing. So I'm going to take the kit here from Mitchell with the flange down, like so. Take these nifty things. It's a nut on top of these hex screws. So we're going to thread these into three of the holes in the banjo housing. Like so. I already pre-greased the threads a little bit. Get our 13/16 Allen wrench, which comes with the kit. Try to get these threaded down as much as you can. You want as much bite as you can get on those threads. Down against the plate. just like when it came out, you got to make sure you get this thing pressed in evenly. You don't want to get cockeyed and crack the banjo housing. So make sure these are tight with the hex. All right, let's go 9/16 deep socket. We'll start pressing this in. With the keyway facing you, I'm going to thread this nut on. Remember, we indexed this so we know where to put it back where it was, so we have the proper preload. Feels like it's getting tight right there. And we got our mark right there where it was. That is just about right. I'll rotate that. I'll feel it again. Feels about right. Good. Now with that, remember our washer, we didn't bend the bottom one up, so we left it where it was. So if I put this exactly back where it was, it should fall exactly into place again. And it did. So there it is over our bottom washer. Now I'll put our top nut on and get this tight. And then we'll bend that back up. And when you stop being able to turn it, that's it. Feels good. All right, now. Oops. Trying to do that right. Perfect. Before putting the overdrive on, I got to put this coupler on the end of the shaft. It's a nice little note. It says make sure you get this side facing towards the overdrive. So they put a zerk fitting on these now, which is kind of nice. The idea is to get it greased so you don't wear these out. So I like to just put a little bit of grease right onto the teeth anyway first before I even slide this on. I'll do the same with the output shaft. I'll go ahead and some grease in here so when we put the Mitchell overdrive on, it gets pre-greased. We don't have to wait for it to get from the zerk all the way over to the teeth. It's just already there. There we go. Get that. Now the next step, we got to do some heavy lifting. Make sure it doesn't leak. There's a little bit of debate going on with people who like building their Model A's to the judging standards. From the factory, these did not have a gasket right here. And there's a group of people who thinks they did have a gasket. Well, they did not. So, but we put gaskets nowadays because we like our nice clean garage floors. Centered. Looks like it. Okay, I've got the owner of the car, Bill, here. He's gonna give me a hand. Because this thing's not light. Fuck, sorry, right, sit it down for a second. Get that out of the way. Alright. Alright, let's see. This is the bottom. Okay, here we go. Ready?
Yep.
Okay. At some point it's gotta engage that shaft. Okay, just hold on to that. Got it. Just gonna center it here. Feel centered. Take this. Okay.
There it is.
Okay, and make sure that's straight.
Bolts look good. Bolt holes look good.
Yep. Get a couple of these started.
Yeah.
started. Hold that. Just gonna get this kind of in place here. There we go. All right. Good to go. Ta-da! Next step is to put the safety wire through each of the bolts that holds the torque tube on. They all have a hole in the head, like most of us do. So use this 19 gauge stainless wire. This is what I use. The stuff that the Model A part suppliers sell is different gauges, but as long as it fits through the hole and it keeps a set when you bend it, it stays that way. That's pretty much all you need. Before we put it in the car, we're going to put the lubrication in. This is 75-140. Mitchell recommends like a 90-140 type oil. This will work just fine. All right, we got the first quart of fluid in the Mitchell Overdrive. Now, the big moment. It's time to put this back under the car.
This is the part of the job where you start to feel like you're really getting something accomplished.
Can I get the spring up in here? All right, now I just got to get that bolt to go in the hole. Like so, I think. That's good. Somewhere. There it is. At least now we don't have to worry about the spring grenading on us.
Not yet.
We don't want to super over-tighten these. What happens is people over-tighten these, and then if you go over a big enough bump where your rear axle's kind of hanging from here, you'll bust these. Because the rear axle, when there's no weight on this, that spring flexes down. You got to leave it some room to flex down. So you don't get these as tight as some people think.
That's why you got cotter keys.
That's why there's cotters in it. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, I didn't have cotters in mine.
This is the part of the job where you usually realize you forgot to put the other part of the gasket in. The clamshell has two gaskets that look identical. One goes on each side of the plate that squishes in between the transmission housing and the clamshell housing.
Alright, let's get the vent in here. They send this, and the idea is you're supposed to connect this, that little rubber hose, so that the overdrive, instead of like if it once it warms up, the oil and air and everything, it starts to expand. The idea is that you have that expansion go through this vent tube and you vent this somewhere up high and connect it to the frame rail up here. And the reason for that is you don't want the oil to run out of here, you just want any warm air coming out, and that's it, and call it good. Okay. I'll just run the vent tube, and then I'll just tuck it up here. Then I'll use a frame clip, and I'll just hold it to the frame rail right up here, like that, and that'll hold it. Thing is, you got to get the speedometer cable. Goes in the Mitchell Overdrive here, and then runs under the chassis. I'm going to get you all dizzy now. Right up here. And then it connects right there, if you can see it, to the regular speedometer cable. And All right, now the overdrive's in and we tested it. So now we got to mount the linkage. So I'm going to take these two bolts out, this one and this one, of the shift tower. And we're going to mount the special Mitchell lever holder thingamabobber. I don't know what it's called. It's probably a fancy name for it. They also include two new screws to hold it on, so we can discard these or put them in our spare box for when your friend comes over and doesn't have one. That's what's going to hold our shift lever right there. Okay, now the part that gets everybody. We got to mark where in the floorboard to cut for the shifter. So the way I do that is I put the shifter in, since we got the bracket installed, upside down, shove it in as far as it'll go. Now, install the floorboard ever so carefully. Make sure it's in position. Now we're going to go under the car and we're going to mark the bottom of the floorboard where to cut.
So here's the edge right here. I put my hand right in the way of where you're trying to see what I'm doing. All right. I'm going to mark right here. That's where it goes, right there.
There we go. Perfect. And just never mind the splintered plywood. So rather than wait until I've installed the shift lever and then grease it through the zerk fitting, I go ahead and just grease the shaft before I slide it in. Of course, 99% of the grease is going to come out. That's fine. That's what we have rags for. I'll just wipe off the extra. So, no big deal. Okay, let's get our linkage ready. Get it down here. Take this screw all the way out, because if you don't, you'll never get it on here because the screw indexes into that little slot right there when it's on properly. So we don't know exactly where this is going to end up yet. So whichever spline you set this on, after you connect the other end to the overdrive, you can decide where your lever is going to end up when you're in which position. So for right now, I'm just going to press it in. I'm not going to put the screw in just yet. Now we got to head under the car and hook up the overdrive.
Up the other end like that. Of course, I drop it.
Okay, now I'll just get my open end wrench and we'll tighten that down. Okay, that's nice and tight, and we've already gone ahead and greased the shaft, the front shaft, and we greased the U-joint, and I think we're just about ready to go. Okay, once the other side of the linkage is hooked up to the overdrive, now you can tell where your throws are going to be, and it just ends up, this is a little too far forward. Ideally, what you want when you're in low is you want it back towards the seat, and when you're in high, you want it about where it is here. So I'm going to pull the shift lever out and move it where I want it to be. For low, and then slip the spline slide back on. Now there's my high and low right there. That's right where I want it. Now I'll go ahead and put the screw in, and I'm going to struggle with this for a minute, so I'll come back after I've gotten this in and I'll report. All right, now after adjustment, exactly what we want right there.
All right, it's getting kind of late. The car is almost ready to go, but look at this gorgeous sunset going on out here. So you know what we're gonna do? We're gonna sit right there and we're gonna enjoy the sunset and we'll pick up again tomorrow morning.
Okay, the brake rods are all put together again.
All right, finally time to button this up and get the floorboards in. All right, everything's been double checked. We've gone over everything the third time, and now we're ready to take it on the road and check it out. First time driving it with a Mitchell.
Here we go.
Straight.
Gotta find the clutch again.
Clutching my Mitchell.
still get used to it.
Well, there we go. Another successful Mitchell Overdrive installation. Thank you so very much for watching this video. If you want to see how to operate a Mitchell transmission, this was just installing. A previous video I did shows you how to operate the Mitchell transmission and all the different things you can do, splitting gears and all that. That's another video, link in the description below. Before I go on, I want to thank a couple of very, very special people. Eugene Levin, thank you so much for your very generous donation. Eugene Levin's donation made this entire video possible, so thanks again. And also Replications Company, thank you so much for your continued donations. And thank you, Bill and Barbara Link, for letting me borrow their car. And I sure miss this car. Why did I sell this car? This car's fantastic. Why did I sell it? I don't know. Should have kept it. Well, yeah, like I need more Model A's. Okay, never mind. I take it back. Thank you again for watching, and I'll catch you on the next video. Don't let me buy any more cars, whatever you do. Don't let me buy any more Model A's.
Oh, now's the time to click the subscribe button and become a subscriber to this YouTube channel. If you do, your Model A will not break down on the next tour. That's how karma works.